the scripture?
Nah. Our thought for today, Brother Mike, yes. Our thought, our topic for today is breaking the status quo. Amen. Breaking the status quo. We begin with verse 6. The Lord God spake unto us in Horeb, saying, you have dwelt long enough in this mount. Turn and take your journey and go to the mount of the Amorites. And please note that the Amorites are always those people who are in opposition to God's people. Go to the mount of the Amorites and unto all the places near thereunto, in the plain, in the hills, and in the vale, and in the south, and by the seaside, to the land of the Canaanites, and unto Lebanon, unto the great river, the river Euphrates. Verse 8. Behold, I have set the land before you. Go in and possess the land which the Lord swore unto your fathers, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, to give unto them and to their seed after them. I spoke from this text here at church before, maybe 5 or 6 years ago, but I've read this very text before. But I feel like the Lord wants us to talk about this just a little bit more, especially in view of the fact that the prophets came forward, that this year is our year. As a church, we are going to break out and step into what God has called us to be, amen, and do what God has called us to do. And if you notice that lately, we have been getting, trying as much as we can to get people involved, not just the same group of people anymore, but we want people to be involved because we are getting ready for what God is going to do. We know that God has been using people in this church, but we also know that there are others in our church that God is going to use. And so we want to make sure that the ministry is open so everybody who's called and appointed by God can function in the ministry where God has called them to function. Now, we must understand that if we are going to get where God wants us to be, we have to break status quo. Status quo is that vacuum that society has created with the intent that we might float around in it without the drive, the know-how, or the desire to go beyond its walls. Miles Monroe wrote, he says, the poorest man in the world is the man without a dream. It doesn't matter the wealth he manages to accumulate. If he does not have a dream, he is poorer than dirt. He also said that the most frustrated man in the world is a man with a dream that never becomes a reality. No matter how poor or how rich we are, whether we were born in the bush village of an underdeveloped country, or amidst the marble floors of the aristocracy of society, we all have childhood dreams. And these dreams are visual manifestations of our purpose. They are the seeds of destiny planted in the soil of our imagination. It seems logical to conclude, beloved, that God gave us the gift of imagination to provide us with a glimpse of our purpose in life and to activate the hidden ability within each of us. You see, everybody sitting in church, we all have a gift. We all have been blessed with something that the person next to you does not have. It makes us different. It makes us unique. I understand that with the whole concept of peer pressure, the idea of peer pressure, we feel like our job is to try to fit into society. But if God wanted us to fit into society, he would have made us all the same. We don't need to fit into society. We don't need to fit in the church. God made us the way we are for a specific purpose. What we need to do is identify the difference in us and then celebrate that difference that is in us because God has made us this way. You see, purpose is the source of the dream and the vision that we carry in our heart from childhood and it is the key to our fulfillment. If we understand what our purpose is, then we will strive for the fulfillment of our life's goals. Have you ever discovered that you have lived a few years without knowing exactly where you belong? Sometimes you walk into where you belong and you think you've found it, but then there are other times when you really don't know, and because you don't know, you try to do what everybody else does. It leads us into a state of confusion, and we need to understand, why is it that God made me the way He made me? Why is it I am the way I am? Why is it I can't fit in? Let me tell you a story that I read sometime back in the early 80s. There was a story of a chicken, a mother hen. She had a few eggs that she was setting on. And if you're not from the country, you probably won't even quite understand this, because I learned now that eggs are hatched by electricity.
Yeah.
But if you lived in the country like I did, so the hen, the mother hen lays the eggs and she sets on it for a few days, about a few weeks, I think 3 weeks or something like that.
21 days,
3 weeks, right. And after 21 days, the eggs crack and the chickens come out, new chickens. And so the story goes on to say, this mother hen had a set of eggs. And she sat on the eggs for a while, and then after 21 days, the eggs began to hatch. But then after the eggs were hatched, one of the chickens came out looking different. They began to grow, and its bill or its beak begins to bend. And then she watched the other chickens eating from the ground, picking up the grains of corn or whatever feed he could find in the ground. But this one particular chicken had difficulty doing so, especially when the feed got low. Notice that as the day goes on and the chickens began to mature, they noticed that this one chicken that is different was able to soar above the others. While the others tried to jump up the step, it just floats up the step. Suddenly, they wanted to go out in the pasture and graze, but there was a mesh fence. All the other chickens were struggling to find a way to get beyond the other side of the fence, but this one chicken just soared over the fence. They were out in the pasture one day grazing, and a mother eagle was up in the air soaring, looked down and saw what looked different, and figured, no, that's not a chicken, that's not a hen, that does not belong there. And the mother eagle called out, and this one chicken that once saw the friend looked up and saw something that looked just like her, spread her wings and took off. Didn't try to fit in. She realized that she was the way she was because God made her to be different from everything else around her. And so I want to bring this message across today, that God what we should try to find out is, why God made me, what purpose does God have for my life, and then walk into God's purpose. If you put the first slide back before me, please, so we can go on to verse 6. You see, we should see the branch status quo, and if we're on the branch status quo, it is going to call for great resistance against the norm. The Bible says in verse 6, the Lord on this mount. You have stayed long enough on this mount, and I've come to tell us. I understand that we're a church, we're a great church, and I love this church. We are a family, we are happy, we are comfortable. But I've come to tell you today that we are not where God wants us to be as yet. We have not yet attained the highest ideal of God for our lives. We need to get further. And the scripture says, God said, you have so we must resist, amen, the norm. And I know that there are those of us who are strong out in tradition, and this is what I know. This is the way I know. But let me tell you that this is the last year, this past year is the last year that we're remaining what other churches are. Starting this year, we are coming into what God has called us to be. And I'm here to tell you that we're going to move from this mountain, because God has higher mountains. Yes, it will take us through valleys. Children. We have to resist against the norm. Now the norm is a construct of society that is designed to prevent us, amen, from excelling into our superior quotient. Traditionalism, we are about to break that demon. What am I accustomed to? This is not the way I know it. We are about to step out of that. We are about to step into this verse. Whatever the will of God is, that's what I'm going to do. Whatever God wants of me, that's what I'm going to give God. Wherever God is going to lead me, that's where I'm going to go. You have got to understand that nothing that God made is average. Nothing God makes is average, but sad society would have us believe that we have no need to meet God's ideals. But I come to tell you that it doesn't matter what happens in and around you, God is still holding us responsible for his purpose for our lives. As Christians, we should determine to shake ourselves from the company of some of our fellow pilgrims. Did I say that right? Did I come out? That's not to say that. Yeah, I did. I did. We should determine to shake ourselves from some of our fellow pilgrims and understand their purpose in our lives as enemy and devils. Because you know we have some Christians whose job, or they think it's their job, to hold you back and make you do what they think you should do. And if it's not according to what is normal, you shouldn't do it. Listen, you know, listen, can I tell you this? It would be so funny, Mr. Mathis, to go out in the street and to see the Range Rover. You put the pro-red Range Rover in neutral and have a horse dragging the Range Rover. Oh, some of you didn't quite get that. You see, the purpose of the Range Rover is to be driven and to drag anything you're tied to it, and to have the horse in front dragging it is wrong. And many Christian people have people who say that they are saved for a long time, and in your church, we have them directing your life, and the fact is they are not going anywhere.
Anywhere.
He didn't tell you not to eat anything or drink anything. He said, careful who speak into your life until you got God said so. I love the way John writes, and he John didn't write a whole lot of things. But here's what John wrote, Ricky. He said, "Beloved, believe not every spirit, but try the spirit whether they are God."